Very good evening to all of you. Thanks for tuning in to the Sunday edition of the Urban Debate. I'm Afrida Rehman Ali. We are going to look at the overall situation in the country in terms of the massive surge in cases that is happening, but we are going to have our special focus on the capital city of Delhi. And just to give our viewers an idea of how the number of cases have increased in terms of the daily cases in the last 12 days, the positivity rate in the country has doubled to 16.7%. It used to be somewhere around 8%. That's the daily increase we are talking about. And when we look at the weekly increase, that positivity rate for the country at large stands at 13.5%. That is the rate at which the cases are increasing. There are 10 states contributing to 78.5% of the total infections in the country. But what is most critical right now is to look at the issues faced by the national capital. Chief Minister Arvind Kejriwal addressed a press conference earlier today, and he made a few points which, almost as an admission, the AAP government in Delhi is now saying that the state is facing a crisis with upwards of 25,000 detected in the last 24 hours. The numbers are increasing at a rapid pace, where the positivity rate in Delhi is 30% right now. Also, the issue of shortage of ICU beds and shortage of oxygen being faced by the citizens. So we are going to ask our expert panel today on how can this kind of an alarming rise be arrested at this point with a 30% positivity rate. What can be done to arrest the surge in Delhi? What are the problems faced by the people of the capital city, and how can they be addressed? Can the new lockdown measures help Delhi? The weekend lockdown is in place, but there are a number of relaxations even now. Is there a need to relook at that? And most importantly, we'll talk about the stumbling blocks in the testing tracing process. Remember, the labs are now overburdened, and also in the vaccination process. Is there a demand supply gap that need to be looked at? We are going to get our experts to tell us more about how, as an individual, we can protect ourselves from the second wave, given the fact that this time around there are new symptoms. The virus has reinvented ourselves. There is a lot which lies in the territory of the unknown. Let me introduce my guest this evening, Dr. N.K. Arora, Executive Director of INCLEN and Chairman of the COVID-19 Working Group National Technical Advisory on Immunization. Also, Dr. Rajeev Das Gupta, Chairperson, Center of Social Medicine and Community Health, JNU, and also member of National Adverse Effects Following Immunization, AEFI, Committee. Reena Gupta, spokesperson of the Aam Aadmi Party, also with us here on the Urban Debate. Thank you all, gentlemen, and Reena Gupta, for joining me here on Urban Debate. We are going to address quite a few important issues this evening. But before we go across to the questions that I have for you, let's first listen into what Arvind Kejriwal had to say earlier about the ground situation in Delhi and what is being done to address the concerns.
ज़्यादा चिंता की बात ये है कि पिछले 24 घंटे में पॉजिटिविटी रेट बढ़ के लगभग 30% हो गया है, जबकि ये उसके पिछले 24 घंटे में केवल 24% था. 24% से बढ़ के 30% पॉजिटिविटी रेट हो गया. बहुत ज़्यादा तेज़ी से केसेस बढ़ रहे हैं. दिल्ली सरकार की तरफ से हम 6000 अगले 2-3 दिन के अंदर, मैं उम्मीद करता हूँ कि 6000 से ज़्यादा बेड्स, हम ऑक्सीजन बेड्स हम तैयार कर लेंगे.
Dr. N.K. Arora, coming to you first on the big concern that we have at the moment of opening out the immunization program. It seems there are some real constraints faced by the country. If you went through the recommendations made by former Prime Minister Dr. Manmohan Singh, the need of the hour, many experts feel, is to ramp up the vaccination process. But if I am looking at the data currently, what it shows me is that there's been a decline in the average daily vaccinations in this country. And what we are also getting to know that at this rate, to vaccinate 75% of the population is going to take us 15 months. That is what my research team tells me. Do we have the luxury of that with the way the numbers are increasing at the moment, Dr. Arora?
Thank you very much for inviting me. I would like to, as far as immunization is concerned, first of all, we need to understand what value immunization brings to the table. all the vaccines available anywhere in the world today do not prevent infection. They reduce the severity of infection. They reduce the need for hospitalization, and they practically eliminate the eliminate the untimely death. These are the three factors. Now, and that is the reason that immunization has been kept for people over 45 years. And we have 40 crore people above the age of 40. The whole purpose at the moment should be to immunize these. Now, as I understand, yesterday there were 60,000, almost 60,000 immunization centers. 60,000 immunization centers should be able to immunize at least a crore of people per day. That means, because the capacity of each immunization center is about 200. Even if we say that it is 100 per 50%, even then we should be able to immunize 6 million people every day. But we are immunizing only 2 to 2.5 million people every day. The highest was in the first week of April, 4th or 5th April, when 4 million people were immunized on a single day. But thereafter, it is hovering between 2 and 3 million. So what I'm trying to imply is that people have to come forward and get the elderly immunized, because it is the maximum benefit there we get. 88% of the deaths are in that population.
Okay.
And if you look at the hospitalization and need for hospitalization, need for oxygen, almost 80% of all those who require this are above the age of 45. So it makes most optimal sense that these are the people who should be targeted for immunization. Mm-hmm. I will stop at that.
Okay, so, you know, we were looking at prevention. We were not looking at the damage control issues, which is, of course, oxygen supply, your medicine supply, the availability of beds. All that comes when there is already, when you're addressing the infections. I was addressing first the issue of what are we doing for prevention. Dr. Dasgupta, do you agree with this? Because there is this common perception and a lot of FAQs on this that those vaccinated are getting infected. So is the importance of immunization overstated? Like Dr. Arora was saying, that it can only avert mortality. It can prevent you from getting severe symptoms. Beyond that, there is only a limited effect that the country can expect through widespread immunization.
Well, there is no disagreement with Dr. Arora said, but it's not really an either-or situation. Mm-hmm. The challenge, as we see all across the country, including in Delhi, is the very rapid rise in the number of new cases. But keep the big picture in mind that currently it is 1.8 million total active cases. So what really puts pressure on the health services anywhere, in each of these states or towns or cities, is the cumulative total number of cases, a certain percentage of whom would require hospitalization, intensive care, etc. So it is this cumulative load that really governments are battling with. The point is that even after 1 year, are we prepared enough? Now some of the big messages is that there are huge problems, whether it's in terms of oxygen supply, in terms of medicine supply, and so on. Plus, testing capacities are clearly saturated. So what next? Now, what next requires two broad approaches. Vaccination will go on in the background. Vaccination is not going to dramatically change or arrest things overnight. So to a certain extent, vaccination will remain in the okay. background without I being misinterpreted. As far as the foreground is concerned, the question is that do state governments actually have adequate capacity? Currently, it is being absolutely stretched, which also means that the health services will increasingly shut itself to non-COVID needs. And there are extremely critical chronic non-COVID needs also, which we're gradually resuming. And now all that will come to a stop. Therefore, how does really the health service augment itself? Now, one of the conditions to be thought seriously, and this is without any political implications, purely as a public health managerial aspect, is actually to bring in the extra capacity that lies with the armed forces. The civil administration everywhere has a finite capacity. In a real disaster situation, all kinds of disasters, the additional reserve actually comes from the armed forces. And this is the time to mobilize. It's high time that it should have been mobilized. It's one thing to take over a banquet hall. It's one thing to convert an indoor stadium, to put beds into an indoor stadium, but to make it into a functional high-tech care center, you actually need trained personnel and an immense supply logistics system that goes with it.
Right.
State governments are clearly
saturated. Well, I'll take that point to Reena Gupta, that on paper you may be saying we have roped in this facility or that facility, railways are also pitching in. It is one thing to add to the numbers simply the isolation bed, but it's quite another to have all of these beds serviced with critical care, which is, of course, the need of the hour. Before I go to Reena, let me just play out this conversation that my colleague Ayushman had with one of the heads of a testing lab. Now, remember, at this point of time, the immediate concern, immediate issue faced on ground in Delhi is the overburdened lab testing and diagnostic centers. Let's listen in to what the labs have to say on why they are not able to deliver the test reports on time, which of course would have its own consequences. Let's listen in.
The testing definitely has increased threefold now from the pre-surge time. And the home collection has almost increased four times. We have a huge number of calls coming for the home collections. And definitely the sample collection rate has almost gone up.
We also witnessed that there is always a kind of delay in giving the RT-PCR results, and people normally say that at least 72 hours is the time frame that is being taken. What is the status right now in this laboratory, and how much of time period has increased compared to the first peak, if we talk about that?
So despite the huge number of samples at GeneStrings here, we don't have any problem in the infrastructure and the testing capacity. The problem basically comes from the manpower, because there's a mandate from the government that within 24 hours, all data has to be entered at the ICMR portal. So the problem comes only with the data entry people and the phlebotomists, definitely, because a lot of people in this surge are also positive in the lab, our phlebos, our data entries. So definitely there's a continuous hiring process where we have to hire the people and we have to get them trained again to be on the show to take so much of samples.
So if we talk about the regular ratio of the results, what is the time frame that we are expecting a person who is getting his test done to receive his result in the nearest possible time?
So at the airport, as you all know, that we are giving the fastest stat in about 6 hours. And at Malviyanagar lab, the samples are being collected and the results are being given within 24 hours as mandated by the government.
So Reena Gupta, this is one area which we are looking at to see, because, you know, there are these two weapons sort of which is being used to address the situation. One is your testing, tracing, isolating. The other is vaccination, which we spoke about. Let's talk about the issues faced in testing. Like, I've spoken to people who are in the middle of the crisis, whose family members are suffering from the infection. One of the things they are pointing out is that we are not able to get the test results on time. So in order to trace people who would have come into contact, if the test results are not delivered in time, that can be potentially a very dangerous situation in terms of spreading the virus. How is your government in Delhi addressing this?
Afrida, I'll be very honest with you. Situation in Delhi is quite grim, as this honorable CM was saying. And, you know, the government is working overnight to increase the capacity of beds, oxygen cylinders, everything. But no matter what we are doing, you know, the infrastructure is being overwhelmed. As you were rightly saying, from around 10,000 cases a day last Sunday, today we have 25,000 new cases every day. As far as tests are concerned, Delhi is still doing 1 lakh yes. tests every day, and 75% of those are RT-PCR. The problem was being faced by a few labs who were picking up more samples than they could process. And I don't want to name the labs, but a couple of labs were under the scanner, and notices have been given to those labs. And they've been told very clearly, please do not pick up more samples than you can process. So we are hoping that the situation will be streamlined in the next 24 hours. The CM, the deputy CM, the health minister, everybody is on the ground visiting hospitals, from the morning till the night. And as we speak, you know, tonight, the information that I have is that 900 ICU beds should be added and 2,000 new beds with oxygen should be added. We've written to the central government requesting them to give us additional beds from the central government quota. You know, Afrida, as you know that Delhi also caters yes. to a huge population from UP and Haryana. And even today, I was looking at the data in the Delhi government hospitals, 30% of the patients in Delhi government hospitals today are actually from UP. So in light of all of this, we've written to the central government to please give us more beds from the central government quota. And we are hoping that by tomorrow, we will yes. have more.
No, I understand the points that you made, which is, of course, drawn from what the chief minister earlier said. I get it that even in a shortage of oxygen, Manish Sisodia has pointed out that there's apparently some hospitals have only 3 to 4 hours of oxygen supply left. Some others have 10 to 12 hours. So like you said, it's a extremely grim situation in terms of these critical care facilities being in short supply. But what I want to understand from you, Reena Gupta, is also that when it comes to people who are not accessing hospital facilities, who are under home isolation, there are bulk of those people who I've also spoken to some of them, who tell me that they are feeling left in the lurch. They are feeling like they have to fend for themselves. Medicines are not available. There is no one checking on them like it happened last time. So is there a helplessness? Is there a situation where the Delhi government is now unable to cope?
Afrida, the home isolation is actually working quite well. And the government, we've hired an agency that calls up everybody who's tested positive twice a day and takes their vital parameters. And, there are also several private hospitals.
Reena. That is not happening. You know that is not happening on a daily basis. I know of people who stay in posh areas like Defence Colony who are telling me, I've got text messages to say, nobody bothers to check on us. There is no fumigation happening. We have to go looking for the medicine. Now imagine a situation where in a family you have an infected person, the others are also exposed. That person is compelled to step out to look for medicines. Is the government really, focusing on these areas, the last mile coverage, the issues where these things can actually lead to a big multiplication of numbers if they are not addressed?
No, Afrida, I completely agree with you that home isolation is one of the most important link in this whole management. And if you've pointed it out that it's not happening, we will obviously work on ramping it up. And as I said, no matter what service yes. it is, whether it is, the availability of injections, everything is being stretched. But having said all this, what I want to say through your channel is that the government is trying its best to make sure that we do everything that is possible to do. And we are managing everything in a very transparent, honest manner. We are not trying to hide numbers. We are not trying to hide anything. Everything is being, because that is the most important thing, that the public should know how bad the situation is so that we all are careful, because, the government can also, can of course ramp up infrastructure, but we also play a very, very important
yes,
part.
Yes, and the issue of hoarding, sure. That is again another aspect. Absolutely. I would request you to look into and request your government to look into that this kind of a panic shortage, Reena Gupta, leads to hoarding. And that again, like I said, complicates matters. So one thing not addressed on time can lead to a multitude of issues. Coming back to you, Dr. Rajiv Dasgupta, in the larger picture now, couple of myths need to be busted. One of them is on whether a person should go in for a vaccine if they are hearing on a regular basis that vaccinated people are getting infected. What would you like to tell people if there is no guarantee of getting not getting the infection after vaccination? Why should they go and get the jab? I just want you to spell it out for our viewers.
It is absolutely true that vaccine hesitancy still exists. It's absolutely true that part of the hesitancy is certainly linked to the potential adverse effects after immunization, particularly the thromboembolic events that's happened all across the world, plus the fact that certain European countries have put the AstraZeneca vaccine on pause, and some have also resumed after that. At the national level, the committee has gone into an in-depth assessment of this. The revised advisories are going to come out very soon. What we can assure at this point is that the adverse effects are certainly not above, and in fact, it's certainly lower than the global experience. So that's an assurance we want to give on behalf of the government and the committee.
Okay.
However, this goes without saying that a lot more proactive communication strategy is required, whether it's the vaccine, whether it's preventive measures, whether it's dealing with home isolation and so on. There's a plethora of risk communication and community engagement processes. That fact is, let's admit it, it remained weak through the year, and this is not about the Delhi government, this is about the country as a whole. Of course, there are variations across states. This is despite the fact that each state has certainly put its best foot forward. Each state has really gone beyond its mandate to make innovations, to do things as best as possible. Yet, whether it's numbers, whether it's the complexity on the ground, things are overwhelmed, let's face it.
Yes, so just since I brought up the issue of how, you know, there are anomalies in those vaccinated getting infected, and like you rightly addressed that issue, let's also address the other issue when it comes to testing. Dr. Arora, if you can give us clarity on why is it that people who have the virus are showing RT-PCR negative, and later with more detailed and thorough diagnostic tests, they come to know that they actually are infected. Now, if there is this kind of an anomaly in the RT-PCR testing, which is supposed to be gold standard, wouldn't that again, you know, be a big challenge in your testing and tracing process?
Thank you for asking this very important question. The whole issue is that RT-PCR is 70-75% sensitive. Now, what does that mean? So if I have 100 individuals with virus sitting there, RT-PCR picks up only 75. Now, I think the question you are asking, that with mutants and with variants, is there a possibility that RT-PCR is becoming less effective in diagnosis? So my answer to that is no. RT-PCR seems to be working almost same as before. The whole issue which the discussion was going on about 30% positivity, and Delhi is doing 100,000 tests every day. Now, the whole purpose is that the number of positivity should come down below 10%. It means unless I'm doing 3 lakh tests in city, my testing is inadequate. And clearly what we heard from you as well as our other friends on the panel, that the capacity is overwhelmed. And let us face that today in Delhi, if I give a RT-PCR sample, my results are given in 2 or 3 days many times because the labs are overwhelmed. So what Rajiv is trying to say, that system is really getting overwhelmed and I think inundated. We are not able to handle it because the number of cases, the beds, the ICUs, the oxygen, the drugs. And therefore, I think the core issue, the fundamental issue, how I prevent infection on my daily basis, even when I'm not tested. So corona appropriate behavior in terms of use of mask is so important. I would say if somebody is seen in public place without mask, I think there should be very severe penalty. The second issue is
which
that
is why, Dr. Arora, thank you for pointing that out. I'm afraid I'm running out of time, but I am going to highlight the point that you made as well as we end the show, that ultimately there is a people. Go ahead, sir. Okay, so the point here is that there needs to be equal participation from people in this fight against COVID-19. Yes, government policy and effective policies are necessary, but what is more important is that people should realize that they can take no chances with this virus anymore. That's it on this edition of the Sunday Urban Debate. Thanks for watching.